G'day again, it's Gary from Ultibo, and today we're doing episode 4 of the Discovering Ultibo series. This is GPIO events this time. Now, you've all probably had a look at the GPIO example in the examples, and you might have wondered, what's the purpose of turning on and off a LED using a computer when you could just hook up the switch to the LED? That's kind of right, isn't it? Don't need the computer in the middle. So we're going to do a little bit more of a fancy example today to show using the GPIO events that are built into the Ultibo driver so that you can trigger when certain things happen and you know, change what's happening in some other part of your program. A bit more of a fancy way to do it than just doing a loop. And I guess any of you who've tried out other GPIO examples will have seen that oftentimes they use a loop to go round and round checking for a switch, and it's sort of simple, but it's not very smart. So what we've got is our Pi 2. It's running a little demo. We've got the Adafruit Pi Cobbler hooked up to it with a breadboard so that we can break out the pins. Now the circuit for this will be on in a little picture on the GitHub Discovering repository so that you'll be able to see the circuit, but it's quite simple. You need a couple of LEDs, a couple of resistors, some sort of breadboard because it's not really sort of smart to solder wires direct to your Pi, and some bits of wire to actually connect it together. I haven't actually got a switch. What I've got is just two bits of wire, one plugged into the breadboard there and another one which I can just touch to the appropriate same line as that wire there. You'll see that and we'll take a close-up shot of this just so that you can see the LEDs. When the switch is off, they alternate. The LEDs alternate backwards and forwards between one on, one off. And when I close the switch by putting that wire in there, we'll see that it comes up on the console as switch is on, and the LEDs both blink together. Now, you can't do that with just a switch and an LED. That's why you need a computer. So a bit more of a fancy example. If I pull the wire out, we'll see that comes up on the console, switch is off, and the LEDs go back to blinking alternate with each other. So that's the example we're going to do, and we're just going to go over to the computer and have a look at what the code looks like for how you do that. So if we go to the computer, we've got Lazarus already open and our GPIO events project open. Now you can see that I started this as just a Raspberry Pi 2 application, completely standard. I've added to the users just the console and the GPIO units so that we can use the functions, so nothing unusual there. I've defined a couple of constants. Now you could just use the numbers in your program, but I like to do it sort of nicely so that you can read it. I've defined switch state off and switch state on to be the values 0 and 1, and a couple of variables, one to hold the state and one to hold a handle for our console window. So if we skip down to where the program starts, which is at the begin section, we'll see that we do a normal console window create and the full position. You've all seen that before. And then we go into setting up the GPIO pins. Now, the circuit will be on GitHub, so you'll be able to see how all this fits together. But we're using pin 18 for the switch, and we do a GPIO pull select to tell the pin 18 to be a pull up. That means that when the switch is not connected, the pin will be high, and we can read that in our program. We also then do GPIO function select to tell pin 18 to be an input. That input is obviously useful so that we can read the value in from whether the switch is open or closed. For the LEDs, we're using pins 20 and 21. But you can use any pins that you want that are available. It's completely up to you. In this example, you're using 20 and 21 for the LEDs. Now, we set both of those to be GPIO pull none, which means that they have no pull up or down resistor on them. We also set the function select of those pins to be function out, and that's useful so that we can send either a high or a low value to that pin to turn the LED on or off. So that's our setup. And then we do a little bit of event setup. So our next line down here is GPIO input get. We read pin 18 which is our switch, and if it equals the level low, we know that the switch must be on. Remember, we did a pull up, so when the switch is off, the level will be high. When the switch is on, it will be low. Backwards to what everybody thinks, but that's the way computers work. We store the state as switch state on, and then we register an event, GPIO input event. Now that requires a few things. First of all, the pin number that we want to register the event for, so pin 18, our switch. What event do we want to know about? So in this case we say GPIO trigger high, and we want to know, because the pin is currently low, we'd like to know when it changes to high. We don't want to be checking it in a loop, just tell me when it changes. And that's what GPIO input event does. It will actually signal you when a pin changes from one state to another. The next parameter is how long to wait for its change. So in this case we're saying infinite, which means wait forever. We've got nothing better to do. Then we have to pass a function. So we're passing the GPIO event function, which we'll go back and look at in just a moment. We can also pass a piece of data to the input event to use in our program. Now the data is not used by the driver, it's completely your choice what you use it for, if you use it at all. Here I'm passing nil, so we're not passing any data at all. Now we can see that the next couple of lines down is basically the opposite case. If the level was not low, if the level was high, we'd set the state to switch state off, and we'd register an input event for when the trigger is low. So opposite to what the current state is, we just register an event for that trigger. So let's go back up and look at the GPIO event function and see what that does. Well, it's actually not much different to what we just did. It sleeps a little bit, 10 milliseconds, just to give the switch time to settle in case there's a bit of a bounce in the switch contacts when they close, so that we don't get a false reading. And then it checks input get on pin 18, our switch, is that level low or high? What should we do? So if it's low, we set the state to on. We print a message on the console in green to say switch is on, and then we register again for the same or for the opposite event. If it's low, we register for high, and we pass the name of the function itself, the function that we're in, as the function to be called. So that's an important thing to realize, is that the event function can actually register to have itself called back when the event occurs. So it's very handy in your programming to be able to do that sort of thing. And obviously the bottom half of that function is the opposite case. If the switch was off, i.e. the level was high, then we set a message on the console to say switch is off in red, and then we register for the trigger low. So that's all the event function does. It's just basically changing the state value, printing on the console, and then re-registering an event. If we go down to our main program again, past where we were, which was the event registration, we find we've got a normal looking loop, but this time we're not checking for the state of the switch, we're just checking the state variable, which is being updated by our event handler. Now when the state is on, we set both pin 20 and pin 21 to high, we sleep a little bit, and then we set them to low, so both LEDs flash at the same time. We sleep a little bit, and then we go around and we do that again. If the state changes to switch state off, then we'll do the other way around. We'll set pin 20 to high, pin 20 to low, so one's on, one's off, sleep a little bit, and then set them the other way around. Pin 20 to low, pin 21 to high, sleep a little bit, go around the loop. So the LEDs will flash alternately, one, then the other, then one, then the other, backwards and forwards. So it's a really simple concept, using the events to actually trigger changes that your program can read elsewhere. And if you expand it out, it can be a very powerful tool that you can take advantage of. GPIO input event, you can register multiple events for different pins. You can register multiple events for the same pin as long as the trigger is the same on all of them. And you can use it in all sorts of places. Obviously being able to pass a data parameter means you can use the same event for multiple different pins because the data could tell you which pin it was and what you were after. So that's as simple as it is. And if we go run compile, it compiles. That's the program that's on our Pi. If we go back to our Pi and we just change our switch, we see switch is on a couple of times because sometimes you get a little bit extra trigger, but it didn't really affect the output. If I switch is off, switch is on, switch is off, and you can have fun with that for hours. So that's all for GPIO events. I hope you found this useful. It's a different way of thinking about programming for embedded devices, and you'll find a lot of it in Ultibo. We're going to try and make smarter ways to do some of these things rather than just the same old, same old. Thanks for watching. Join us again next time when we'll do something else exciting. Bye.